everybody. Thank you for organizing this very nice event. And I will try my best to bring across some of our experiences we had in recent years while working on so-called RISE ecosystem services. This was in the frame of a project called Legato. And now I have one short request, because I think this is the wrong presentation here. And I played up a new one this morning, so maybe you can just try to exchange this one. Just a second, I have to see about this. No, that's not the one. There was one I gave to the translator this morning. Sorry for this. And that's a title which you have in the program. And it's a work we did together with many other people, so I mentioned some colleagues here. Some of the colleagues from international team where we collaborated is Filipinos, it's Vietnamese colleagues, a lot of Germans. And that's what it stands for. Legato has a long title, which is kind of a bit artificial. It stands intensity, the ecological engineering assessment tools for risks and opportunities in irrigated rice-based production systems. We normally only use the short version, so Legato, which comes from music. Legato means something in harmony, so it's a name coming from the decision. We work in Southeast Asia, focus is North Vietnam, Southern Vietnam, and North Philippines. So the next island from here, the next larger one, is on. We have seven regions and about 70 research sites, so 10 per region. We have 24 universities working there, research institutions, NGOs, local stakeholders from Europe and from Asia. Here. This is our team. In the first meeting we had, it's around 100 people working on this, in this context, on these issues. The background is elaboration and testing of generally applicable principles within the frame of ecological engineering, or also eco-agriculture, if you like, which is going in the direction of design, monitoring, and construction of ecosystems, but also preservation of traditional systems, if they have been successful. So we assess services in rice-dominated landscapes. We talk about three different types of so-called ecosystem services. The provisioning ones are those providing us with, let's say, food, for example, so rice and other crops, so the production component, let's say. The regulating one is on biocontrol and pollination, so the two we work on. I don't go much into biocontrol now because Kael Heong will talk about this later today, about the insects and the natural enemies, how they can be promoted through different types of land use. And the cultural diversity aspect, aesthetics, and that's the cultural knowledge, which links, for example, to recreation and ecotourism. Today I'll give a focus on the last part in my talk. But first, what's the purpose of this approach? We want to outline the opportunities for ecologically and economically profound agriculture futures, which means, for example, full intensification strategies based on ecological engineering, which includes local knowledge. So intensification could have very different meanings. In our case, it's oftentimes more intensified labor activities, so more labor has to be put inside the system rather than more fertilizers or pesticides. The whole project has one approach where we start up here, what we call the multi-stakeholder analysis and consultation. This is the baseline, so we have interacted with local stakeholders, get their inputs, but also our own inputs. And through the project, we always have feedback loops. So we always try to get the feedback from the people for whom we work. In practice, this means we sit together, oftentimes here, in the picture in South Vietnam, talk to the farmers, talk to the officials and get their ideas and impressions and wishes and try to combine them with the things we intend to do as scientists. There's a reverse, these are the seven regions. see Taiwan is just up here, just over. So here it's the three ones from Busan. That's near the International Rice Research Institute, south of Manila, central Busan, and the north is the rice terrace area. And also in Vietnam in the north, there's a terrace here, it's a lowland irrigated rice production systems. And you have in the Mekong area also one research site near Ho Chi Minh City. What we do in each of these regions, we have five pairs of sites. Pairs are like this. We've chosen them, some in a structurally richer environment and some in a poorer one, which means with less different structures besides rice fields, to see how landscape context impacts the different elements of production system, like for example the biocontrol services. I'm going to one example region as a study region in Fugao here, in Northern Luzon, in the center of Cordillera, maybe it's just 400-500 kilometers from here, maybe 600 further south, and you are there, just have to cross a little bit of the sea. What are the characteristics of the landscape? You can see here, this is a terrace landscape here. That's a local agricultural officer. It's historical cultural landscape. It's something which is also quite typical for Satoyama activities. It's partly a abandonment of rice terraces taking place now. There's a certain increase of forests because of the abandonment of upland agriculture. Traditional agricultural practices tend to disappear, so there's a loss of erosion knowledge. Secondary incomes are needed, so people have to make different incomes from how they used to be before. And there's a subsistence and family-driven farming. They only have one rice crop per year. Due to climate constraints, you're going to get to it once a year. There is none or very low use of pesticides or inorganic fertilizer. There's a traditional system, how we call it, which is based on very many natural conditions. Does not depend on inputs, for example, of pesticides. So we use this as one showcase of how you may produce a certain type of product, in this case, traditional rice varieties, without being dependent on this modern kind of systems. Just to show you how things are changing, that's one picture from the central area. But now Philippines in 1908, it was taken way back by anthropologists. They went to the same place 100 years later. That's how it looks like. What you can see are two drastic changes. The first one is urbanization. Look here. Former rice fields turn into buildings. The other one is an increase in forest cover. So some of these areas up here have been quite deforested, or somewhere around here. And in newer times, there is more forest growth in some of these areas. So it's a kind of development which is not necessarily good or bad. Urbanization has very different aspects, but of course it's a rather bad one. But diversification or more forests also leads to more biodiversity in the area, for example. So what are the current social cultural drivers, social economic drivers, environmental drivers, and how do they affect biodiversity and land management in this cultural landscape? That's one of the core questions we have asked in our project. What I present now are some snapshots from social science research. I have to say I'm not a social scientist, but I'm a socially minded scientist, not a social scientist. My background is entomology, so I work on insects mainly in my early career. But as I coordinate the entire project, I have to work with many different aspects. What I present now is the result of interviews we conducted in groups, larger groups of farmers, for example. Just a sample of 50, not very much, but it gives you some first idea of what people think about the main problem in the areas. So the main drivers, that's very clear, there's also objective data, there's population growth, of migration, and as I've shown, urbanization. Socioeconomic drivers, that's increasing livelihood costs, gasoline, electricity, education, social media, also food, if you have to import food. Then subsistence small-scale farmers are the target of agrochemical companies, so the industry tries to come in some of the areas, which is of course risky and tricky for our organic production system, They don't call it organic, but in fact it is an organic system. And social culture, the lifestyle changes for the younger generation, that's obvious everywhere. Everybody wants to have more education, which I think is something positive in the end. The generation gap has also been because of social media, for example. But we also can try to make best use of some of these components. So what the impacts of change on the environment and the biodiversity? We have, to some extent, the clearing of mountain forests, which is, let's say, stopped more or less in the meantime. But up to now, people tend to go up in the forest to clear it for some kind of production of vegetables, for example. There's a risk for intensification by chemical inputs. There's a reduced food diversity. So having diverse foods besides rice, other vegetables, for example, this has reduced the number of crops which are used. The loss of additional crop varieties is a big issue. In low-tier places, you can find up to 40, 45 local rice varieties in the old system. Nowadays, it's decreased down to 10 or 15 only. So the knowledge and the system has eroded. And there's a loss of functional linkages between the various elements of the production. So for example, the crop residues used for soil composition, this kind of aspects which tend to also vanish. The impacts on digital land management. There are secondary family incomes, so there's lack of labor power in the fields. It's labor intensive, so it's very hard to convince the younger generation to do this hard work, especially in such speed terms like this one here. There's disappearance of synchronization in the system. It costs for the highly synchronized production system. So all across the landscape, you have only one stage in the rice. You move from a community approach to a more standalone approach. That means individual decisions replace community decisions. So historically, every decision was made on the community level. And nowadays, it's more on the private level or family level. Traditional expert knowledge is no longer applied or applicable. For example, soil requirements of new crops that replace traditional crops. That's a totally new thing, so it's very hard to, let's say, use old experience in these new settings. And we have an erosion of traditional practices and rituals, for example, control pests, or esteemed as old-fashioned by the younger farmer generation. So some of these things are also mental aspects, how you, let's say, regard certain practices. Old-fashioned, that's negative, but it is, let's say, traditional, and you're proud of it, that's something quite different. And the impacts of change in social culture. So traditions, for example, spiritual rituals become historical artifacts. And the change of family structures mentioned before, of migration. You are modified as traditional labor tasks and family responsibilities. If the loss of traditional practices of civilization and the loss of institutions, social hierarchy, for example. Generation gap mentioned before, new lifestyles of the youth, huge opportunities, easy money in tourism, good education leads to off-farm jobs. But I come back to the tourism aspect, because it's one of the components which might also offer, let's say, future opportunities. Further highlights, contrary to what I said before, this old-fashioned thing, there is a high awareness, appreciation of the own culture, especially in the older generation, but also younger ones, step by step, that will appreciate what their forefathers have done and the experience they have. There is a positive landscape perception. So most of these rice terrace areas in northern Luzon are UNESCO World Heritage Sites, which is quite an important aspect also on the national level of the Philippines, but also for international reputation. That older farmers wish children to proceed with rice farming, preserve cultural knowledge and traditions, also provide the family with pesticide-free rice. So the aspect of organic production is already, let's say, deeply rooted in the system. And of course, off-farm incomes, tourism, private workers are very important. So coming back to what I said before, we have these three types of services. Now just going through some pictures on the cultural diversity, aesthetics, and knowledge things, just give you some impressions. The cultural services, there is a kind of categorization, which is about spiritual, it's about sense of place, heritage, inspiration, aesthetics, recreation, and education. that's a kind of theory behind it. I don't go into detail here, but it's a whole set of services which are summarized under cultural services. Let's go into diversity. So as you have here in Taiwan, we have in many of our places minorities, ethnic minorities. That's a picture from northern Vietnam in the Sapa area. There are different tribes living there, different traditions of language, with very traditional clothing. It's all these ikat weaving things which you also may find here in Taiwan, I don't know. Or this is kind of weaving from northern Philippines, also ikat based on natural colors. Very laborious, so this one takes 3 months to finish, this kind of blanket. Very hard to find nowadays. Or you have cycle holdings, Chinese charms in the Philippines. This goes back to the time before the Spaniards. So hundreds of years ago, there have been exchanges between China and the Philippines. And from this time, we still have some of these old, let's say, souvenirs in the place. And this is the old way of living. That's a picture I took 30 years ago when I started working in the area. You can still see the native houses of people living on small villages within the rice fields. For aesthetics, that's about landscape and the impression. These are some impressions of this very steep terrain, which is a landscape very much appreciated, for example, by tourists. Another component of aesthetics, this links a bit to the biocontrol part. If you beautify your landscape with flowers, these are pictures from Vietnam, which is something which people just tend to like because of the impression in the landscape, you also have the effect, beneficial effect on biocontrol. And another picture here. And the biocontrol effect derives from the conditions that the parasitoids, the natural enemies of rice pests, also need nectar sources. At least some of them, but they go to the same places, like for example, bees are going. In the context of our project, we look into biocontrol, but also look into pollination. And here, we use bees as a representative of the whole group of, let's say, beneficial wasps. So the bees are the kind of indicator for the biocontrol service, which is performed by the nephews and nieces of the bees, so the relatives, which are the small parasitoids. Nobody knows them in detail, so it's very hard to communicate. So we use bees to bring across the message. A short excursion on pollination and its importance. It's a big topic nowadays. That just presents two slides. This is a picture of a market in Europe, in France, which shows vegetables and fruits which don't depend on pollination. And if you add those who need pollination, it looks like this. So that shows very nicely the importance of pollination also for human food production. Pollination is also one of these important ecosystem services. Going back to our landscapes in Southeast Asia, so that's kind of aesthetic thing, this different parts of the landscape in northern Luzon. And one important component in the higher mountains, you have this remnants of primary mossy forests. And these forests are to a large extent the guarantee for the permanent water supply throughout the year. So if you produce irrigated rice, you need a permanent water supply. If you want to have this permanent water supply, you're interested in preserving the forests on higher elevations. There is a quite direct link between production and biodiversity conservation, because these forests harbor a lot of endemic species. This is one example. It's an endemic species of the high elevations, 2,500 meters, something like this, in the northern Philippines, the endemic moss species. That's the other aspect of aesthetics. That's one of these amphitheater-like rice terrace areas. That's also the World Heritage Site of the UNESCO. It would be a classical Satoyama type of landscape. Cultural services in terms of knowledge, there's lots of local knowledge also about biodiversity. So here we interview people with certain plates of species, in this case of snails, to see how the local taxonomy looks like. They have local names for the species, and also they know about their ecological roles and about the function the species have. But they also serve, in this case, as food resources, snails here, for example. Or maybe interact with farmers talking about local translators advice about their experience they have in the field. So local knowledge is a very important component as you especially move in the direction of ecological and agriculture. So we did lots of work in collaboration with some Philippine colleagues here from the University of the Philippines in Los Baños, where we interacted with local communities. So we used participatory approaches. Like this one, sitting together with farmers and thinking about their experience of land use change over time, or getting their impression of the flow of resources in the landscape. So here, up there we have the forest, the terraces, we have the housing, we have the market. How they understand how the cycle of products is going, how the cycle of nature is going, how species act there. That's a product done with the cooperation of local farmers. Another aspect of knowledge is knowledge of growing system. So here in the center, this is the rice cycle. They have a kind of harvest season in June, July. That's the traditional cycle. They have an off-season here, planting season of rice, December to March, then the growing season. This indicates high labor intensity. So harvest season is a community activity. Everybody collaborates to harvest. These are old varieties. You can only harvest by hand. There is no machinery to harvest rice. We have different components of landscape. So these ones are the so-called sweet potato fields. So besides rice, people used to grow sweet potatoes in upland and dry conditions. These are different peaks for the working times. But these are increasingly abandoned. As I mentioned before, changes going on, for example, relate to the abandonment of upland agriculture. And the third component are the used forests. So they're kind of woodlots and small forests around the settlements, which are used for production of fruits, for example. So this system is changing. We try to one new thing which is very heavily impacting the system is wood carving. They do kind of traditional wood carving, but sometimes also very strange new kind of things they develop. It's not traditional, this one, but only the wood carving as a process is traditional. So if you look at the system, here again, that's the rice system. Now we have this handicrafts as a new activity in the area. You have paint shops. For example, riding tricycles or jeepneys or taxis for tourists. And you have tourism as the main activity. So things are changing, and the priority of work in such landscapes also might change. But still until now, in this area, rice is a dominating thing in terms of activities. But otherwise, things keep on changing. All systems are dynamic. So if you think about traditional systems, in this rice area, we had the sweet potato, which is regarded as the old, well-known system. But sweet potato came from South America. So the system can't be older than 300 years because sweet potato wasn't there before. So it always takes a little bit of time to regard something as being very original, indigenous, traditional. But these things also keep on changing. So nothing is really constant. Recreation, tourism, but just some more impressions. That's one of the points where people use to take pictures of the landscape as a special platform. Go on tourists, go there, busload, take pictures, and you go to the next place again. And what we also do, we try to get people involved in identifying certain species, the dragonflies and damselflies of rice fields, which we use as indicators. We try to inform students or schools how to, let's say, identify these. That's the close up here. So the most important species are well known. They're very important for the rice ecosystem. So the opportunities which we see is the use of regional characteristics to create perspectives and adequate livelihoods for local population. And tourism is one core component. What is developed now is homeworkcultural tourism, spiritual tourism, nature tourism, or agritourism, sometimes those you combine. With a focus on different target groups, so there's fun and sports team, which is just running across the landscape. Science education one, all of those large, the other ones just enjoying nature. We are going in the direction of participatory development of inclusive tourism strategies. So trying to integrate the poor population and the ethnic minorities. That's something which is very obvious, has to be done, but wasn't done so far. And then to create perspectives for the younger generation, specified education, maybe jobs in the rural sector, or in the agricultural markets. How to improve your system in such a way that they make a living out of it. Which doesn't mean we don't have inputs in terms of fertilizer, but it might have different options how to develop this for the future. So the project is still going on. It will end next year, and we're trying to continue also for some more years, looking for some more funding sources. At the moment, we summarize our research results, of which I've demonstrated only very few. We have demonstration activities, that means people are now planting, for example, flower strips in some areas, and they find out themselves how it affects your yield and your pest abundance. So we have two case studies where a lot of the groups work on this. We have a very successful outreach activity with this TV episodes or soap operas, around 20 of them, developed by KLB and Molina Escalada, some colleagues from our team. And we do some first citizen science approaches, which is still kind of starting. So where to go? One thing you plan is moving into other countries. For example, Taiwan might be possible. That was a picture from yesterday from our trip to Toronto National Park. So that's, I like to hear, maybe there's some chance to collaborate in this context also in your area here. Right about the partners also in Indonesia, for example, so we're trying to get a larger representation geographically. But Taiwan can have a real role as a hub, because you are in a tropical or subtropical setting with very good infrastructure, a high level of education, a high level of knowledge, so you could serve as a showcase for many of the things we are doing further south and South Asia as a whole. We may move beyond rice, so the cabbage you mentioned yesterday. Important here, you have cabbage production in the middle of a very diverse landscape. The important aspect in this cultural landscape is we have a diversity of crops, but also of different structures, which helps to buffer, for example, pest outbreaks. Moving into ecotourism, I've shown this picture before. Aesthetics is often important, but also for hiking tours. Strengthening citizen science, that's an aspect. I don't know how familiar it is in Taiwan. We have activities in the project where people try to look at certain groups of indicators. That's our team here. For example, dragonflies or butterflies or certain crop pests. So this one truly might be an approach which is useful to look, for example, at the quality of water in dragonflies, or let's say the biodiversity, indication function of butterflies, which is a good indicator for many terrestrial habitats. We can go for interaction discussion boards, so how to use social webs in national languages, or in Southeast Asian channels for the English language, that's something we developed, but we might try to further expand this. And I think Taiwan has a very good knowledge on the biodiversity. So there might be also a good showcase to collaborate here. And with image sharing, observation recording, and quality control as a kind of community effort. So citizens being involved in this kind of activities. But there's some of the apps we are working on at the moment, which just helps to identify locations where you spot certain species and to register them on an online system. That's not automatic, sorry for this. Okay. Deepening other research topics is the last aspect here. We want to go deeper into this food web structure, especially how species in your crop area, in your rice field, interact with the surroundings. So looking at the structure of a landscape, that's one of the Philippines, where blue is a rice field, green is some kind of grassland, reddish is a vegetable land. So you see how these different elements interact in terms of food webs. You might look into other aspects I didn't mention so far. We have lots of work done doing in nutrient context. So for example, silicon, one nutrient is very abundant. You can see in the Philippines, there's a lot of silicon in the soil and also in the plant, while in Vietnam, it's quite the opposite. So actually in Vietnam, we have quite a lot of silicon deficient growth conditions. So one direction might go into, let's say, organic compounds to increase silicon content in rice fields. The other aspect might also be, maybe for Taiwan, I don't know, to look at the interaction of silicon with there's one poisonous substance which is very similar to silicon chemically, arsenic. So arsenic and silicon have very close interaction. That might also be something we could go into detail with our people working, especially in the nuclear context. Or about marketing opportunities, about the whole thing of economy and markets. These are local varieties which are sold at a very local scale, partly international. So that's also something which we might go into in the future. I want to thank especially K.L. Leon, because he was my mastermind partner in designing the whole project. He will talk to you later, sitting here in front. And when we first time met, so when I was in the Philippines, so the first time was 30 years ago. The next picture shows me 30 years younger. That's this one. So I started as an entomologist collecting insects in rice fields. That was taken in 1985. Now I gained a bit here, and I lost a bit here. Okay, so thank you very much for your attention. I hope you got some of your